Hi, it's Alex. Today I want to talk about something potentially controversial, and it's whether or not it makes sense to give people more of a voice if they're more oppressed. And I'm going to make a statement that disagrees with a lot of the attitudes and viewpoints that I see in left-wing or liberal ideology. These attitudes that say that if someone is more oppressed, then it's important to give them more of a voice. And I'm not going to say that this is always untrue, but I want to say that it's sometimes untrue, and I want to talk about when I think it makes sense to do this, and when I think it doesn't make sense to do this. So when does it make sense? And what's the whole reason we have this aspect of liberal ideology in the first place? Well, to me it seems kind of common sense. If there's a group of people that are oppressed or marginalized, especially if they're kind of erased from society, their voices are typically excluded. And so you see this with a lot of different things. You see this with women going back a really long time. Like, for years, women were pretty much excluded from most of the mainstream positions of power in society. And so their voices are poorly represented in things like writing, in academia, in politics, all sorts of things like that. And then you see the same thing happening with race, that because black people were brought over as slaves to America, even when slavery was ended, they're still not represented on an equal level relative to their portion of the population as with white people. And you see this with LGBTQ people, with gay people, with trans people, and so on. Like, because being gay was so stigmatized for so long, gay people were forced to live underground and hide their relationships. And so their voices were pretty much excluded from society. Like, people only would write about being gay in these really indirect ways, because if you came out and were like, hey, I like people of the same sex or whatever, people would jump on you. And by jump on you, I mean you might be subjected to violence, you might be excluded from all sorts of social structures and cultural institutions. And all of this was up until fairly recently. So these people's voices have been kind of excluded from society, so it makes sense that you want to compensate for that, and you want to say, hey, let's work to include these people's voices, all the people who have been oppressed or marginalized. We want to listen to them, we want to make sure we're updating our own narrative, our own belief system, our way of thinking, so that we're not including any untruths that they could easily correct by just speaking about their experience. And I generally support this. But I also think that left-wing ideology and subcultures can go too far in giving extra weight to the voices of marginalized people. And I see this happen fairly often in discussions, and I've seen it happen both in person and on the internet. And basically, what will often happen is that one person will say, hey, like, what do you think about this? And the other person will present, like, a disagreeing perspective. And what often happens is that if it's an issue of race, the white person will get shut down. Or if it's an issue of sexuality or gender identity, the cis person or the heterosexual person will get shut down. Whoever is viewed as the member of the more privileged group tends to be the one who gets shut down, and the member of the more oppressed group tends to get their voice amplified. And often this amplification of voice or shutting down of someone's voice is done kind of automatically. Like, people don't examine what is actually being said. And there's some real problems with this. One of them is that members of oppressed groups are often able to get away with more aggressive, hostile, disrespectful, and even abusive behavior than members of the privileged groups in these liberal subcultures. And I've been on both sides of this, and I think it's because my identity straddles these things. I'm white, that makes me privileged, and there's situations in which I've enjoyed male privilege because I am assigned male at birth and I'm generally read as male by most people in a lot of situations. But I'm also non-binary and trans feminine, and my femininity came out in various ways throughout my life and caused me to be bullied and harassed and excluded and subjected to hardships in various ways in various situations. And most people recognize that, most liberal people recognize that, and so I kind of get put into this special privileged box. And I've been in situations where there are other trans people, there are other non-binary people, and they're acting in ways that I think are very disrespectful towards cis people, and people will just jump on and shit on the cis people. And I don't like this. And I've been in situations where people do the same thing for me because I'm white, or also, and it's not fully truthful, I've had people do this because they see me as male. And sometimes people will even lecture at me about things about my experience because I'm male, and they'll make a lot of generalizations that are not true. Like, one thing people will say is like, oh, you have the privilege of not having to think about your gender as you go through your daily life. I'm like, I'm trans, like, don't ever say that to another trans person, that is very insulting. Like, you read me as male, but like, my experience is very different from men in a lot of ways. Okay, so these are some of the ways that this thing can go wrong, that people can hold people to this double standard and allow disrespectful or even abusive behavior from members of the oppressed group, but not members of the privileged group. And privilege in quotes, because people, for some of these identities, they can be invisible. You don't necessarily know if someone is trans or gay by looking at them. They also might be neurodiverse. You also might not have a sense of their socioeconomic background. You don't know whether or not they struggle with mental illness. You don't know whether or not they come from an abusive family situation. There's a lot of types of oppression that can be completely invisible. And so when people make these sorts of assumptions, they can go wrong in a lot of ways. Okay, so there's this facilitating of abusive behavior and kind of turning the other way, and I really don't like it. But there are other reasons and other ways that I think that this practice of giving more of a voice to oppressed people can go wrong. And that is that oppression can skew your way of thinking. And I want to talk from experience about this. When you are subjected to bullying and social exclusion, it can really mess up your mind. I've dealt with years of depression, and depression can severely distort your thoughts. It can distort your belief system, and you can begin to hold irrational beliefs. So, for example, for years I struggled with feeling like people hated me and like I had no place in society. And I would go to an event and people maybe wouldn't be as warm or friendly as I would like them to be, and then I would have this thought process of like, wow, people hate me, I don't belong here, struggling with thoughts like that. And those thoughts are not truthful in an overwhelming majority of cases. That's the whole point of depression. It's a mental illness, a mental disorder, because your thoughts deviate from reality. And for me, that reality was in part a result of how I had been treated when I was younger, and to some degree how I'm still treated in some situations. That people treat me negatively, but then I internalize it, and I start holding these irrational beliefs. And if you always give more of a voice to more oppressed people, in all circumstances and without questioning, you are going to end up amplifying the voices of people who are struggling with mental disorder. And I've seen this exact thing happen, that people will start voicing irrational ideas, they will start talking about how they are hated and how they are excluded from society, and their thoughts will make it seem worse than it actually is. And in some cases, I know these people and I've seen situations that they're talking about, and I can clearly see that some of the things that they're saying are irrational. Like, they'll be like, wow, these people hate me, this group wanted to exclude me, and I'll know the people in the group, and I'll know that they weren't feeling that way, and that it's this mental illness speaking there. And if you just give more of a voice to oppressed people without questioning, it can allow those harmful ideas to persist, and that can be really, really damaging. And I think this actually was one of the reasons why I struggled with depression in my first few years out of college. I went to Oberlin College, which was a super liberal college, super left-wing, and I was exposed to a lot of this far-left ideology. And I think I internalized a lot of it. And I think a lot of it was very damaging to me and actually placed me at higher risk of depression and made it harder for me to overcome depression, made me fall deeper into it, and it was really damaging. I spent a number of years of my life struggling with suicidal thoughts and self-destructive behaviors associated with this mental illness. So this is really ugly stuff. I want to talk about one more example of this, which is in discussions of wealth and poverty. This is another situation where left-wing ideology tends to want to give more of a voice to poor people and not rich people. And I think there are times when this makes sense. Like, if you're talking about the ways in which a person struggles that a wealthy person might take for granted the privileges that they had, it makes sense to give poor people a little bit more of a voice. But poverty isn't just the result of situations beyond people's control. It's also a result of people's mindset and behaviors and ways of thinking. And this is where I'm siding to a degree with conservatives. I'm pretty moderate, and you'll notice that I hold a blend of liberal and conservative views on these issues. And poverty is, it's an interaction. It results from an interaction of these external systemic factors that the person doesn't have control of, and internal factors, the person's own choices, beliefs, and ways of thinking. And I've noticed this in people that I know personally. I've seen people move from poverty into wealth, and I've also seen some people, unfortunately, go the other way. And I've seen that certain behaviors that people engage in can really either keep them in poverty or help them get out of it. And I've noticed that, like, an example of this is long-term thinking in purchasing decisions. And this interacts with the constraints. Like, if a person has very little money and they're living paycheck to paycheck, they don't necessarily have the ability to think long-term. But when they do, if they're not in that mindset, when they do have a little extra disposable cash, if they're still thinking short-term, they might blow that money. And I've seen people do this all the time. One thing that's really frustrating is I've been in these situations where there are people from diverse socioeconomic backgrounds talking about things, and several of the people who are basically really poor, they're in a situation of low socioeconomic status, they have low income, very low net worth. Those people will be talking in ways, and some of these bad habits and bad choices that they make will come out. And some people who are wealthier and are better off will speak up, and they're like, hey, you know, you could do this, maybe you could do this. And it's tricky, because some of the things that they say, that they suggest, might not actually be possible for those poorer people. But some of the things might be. And if you're stuck in this sort of toxic left-wing ideology that says always give more of a voice to the oppressed people, the wealthier people there often will get shut down. And that's very bad, because it keeps them from sharing their good financial habits with the people who are less well off and who might actually benefit from those habits. And this is something that I've observed happen numerous times. I also have seen the other happen. I've seen where people who are better off share advice, and it really ends up helping other people. I've been able to do this myself. I'm pretty good at managing resources. I don't have a very high income, but I have a pretty high net worth relative to my income, and I'm pretty good at helping other people to get into a better place financially. And so I know that when you're given that space to speak up about financial management skills and habits, you really can help people. Basically, this is what I had to say. I know this is a pretty long video, but these are complex topics. I think it's important to not have like an all-or-nothing stance on this issue. It's really good to give marginalized and oppressed people more of a voice, but it's important to not do that without reason. And there are two reasons. One of them is it's important not to allow or turn the other way when marginalized or oppressed people engage in abusive or hostile behavior towards other people. And the second is that sometimes being marginalized or oppressed tends to distort your way of thinking, either through mental illness or through just bad habits, things like that. And it's important to allow privileged people to speak up and to help oppressed people into better habits and more truthful ways of thinking. People have done this to me, I've been able to do this to other people, and I'm very grateful for these exchanges. Yeah, that's what I have to say. I hope you found this interesting and thought-provoking, and I hope this can make a difference in the world. And if you like what I have to say, I always appreciate when people subscribe to my channel. Thank you!